You might have thought that after 4 years' absence, Depeche Mode were on their way down. You'd be wrong. Depeche Mode are on their way up. Why did you decide to release Barrel of Gun as the first single?
Because it's the most hard-hitting, and we think that, you know, after a four-year absence, that we should, you know, we should come back with the song that sounds necessarily most like Depeche Mode, or the one that is necessarily the most commercial.
That's why we went with Barrel of Gun, because we felt it was the most innovative thing that we've recorded in a long while.
Underworld remixed Barrel of a Gun. How did that come about?
The record company rang them and said, would you be interested in doing it? They listened to the song, they liked it, and so they did it.
Yeah, it was a real coup for us because they don't do remixes generally. So, you know, we're really honoured, especially when we got the mixes back, because both the mixes are totally innovative.
You did it mammoth tour, about 18 months. How did you keep that going?
I didn't.
We bet Fletch actually.
That
would have been the nearest we've ever come to actually, like, during work, like, I think probably broken up, you know, just because of the sheer pressure, you know.
It was too long.
It was too long, and all of us suffered in all different kinds of ways up to it. Alan left the band, Fletch, like, decided that he couldn't handle the whole thing anymore for a while. You know, Martin and myself were pretty sick for a long while after the tour, just drained mentally and physically. And I think we've learned our lesson.
Dave, the lot has been written about your excessive lifestyle, shall we say. What did you learn from that?
I learned I can't do it anymore. It wasn't just times when I felt really low, you know, during it. Sometimes when I'd just be on a natural high, I would still do terrible things to myself, you know. I felt like I had no balance. I couldn't control the way I felt.
When we got the phone calls about, you know, that he'd done this and done this, you know, if I got a phone call saying he was dead, you know, I wouldn't have been surprised, you know. It wouldn't have been a major surprise to me.
You know, it wouldn't have been a surprise to me either. You know, before I went into hospital last time, I was actually dead for 2 minutes. You know, whatever you think about that. And the insanity of it was as well, I just, when I came out of jail, when I was arrested for possession of drugs, and I still went out and repeated the same thing. I didn't feel I had a choice, that was the problem. But, of course, you know, I found out since then that there is a choice. It's just a matter of actually reaching out and asking for the help. Today, right now, is so much... I can't even explain how much better it is with all its shortcomings, you know, or whatever. I mean, the quality of my life today, right now, is so much better, you know.
As the drugs debate rages louder than ever in the UK, Dave's comments come at a time when there is still an assumption that drugs and music go hand in hand.
Do you think it's part and parcel of being in a band?
I think you have a choice. I think it doesn't have to be.
The thing is, though, people, there is a lot of underlines. You know, it's a job that everyone wants, you know, obviously, to be in a band, but, you know, it's also something that you're not trained to do. And there is a lot of underlying stress all the time, and a lot of free time. It's a bit like a footballer who finishes training at 12 and then gambles the rest of the day because he's got nothing else to do. Whatever I've done,
it's never been a barrel of a gun. You've just finished your new album. What was it like recording it?
Interesting.
There was times during the making of the album where we didn't even think we were going to get it finished, maybe, or, you know, but in retrospect, it was the last, especially the last 6 months, it was really productive, you know, we'd done a lot of work.